Thank you very much. Thank you, Chairman Angeles, for your very kind introduction, for your tribute, and for organizing this very important event. Vice President De Castro and the other members of the cabinet, Attorney Angeles and the Angeles family, the faculty, staff, and students of Angeles University, my brother Arthur and the other members of the family, City Mayor-elect Ed Pamintuan, and Vice Mayor-elect Vicky Vega, who used to be my speechwriter, and the other officials of Angeles City, especially Congressman Tarzan Lasatin. Dear friends, first of all, to Angeles University, happy 48th anniversary of your school and happy 39th anniversary of the foundation. Congratulations. And to Manny Angeles, thank you for welcoming us back to Angeles University on the occasion of your school's anniversary and for including in this anniversary celebration the kickoff of the commemoration of our father's 100th birth anniversary. Our family is grateful that you remember Diosdado Macapagal not only as president of the country, but very fondly as chairman of the board of directors until his death in 1997. Thank you for honoring his legacy, not only as chairman of the board, but also as president. His legacy is now going to be remembered because you are helping enable Filipinos for generations to come to know his life and times and his contributions to the Filipino nation, and to be able to remember those memories from an objective and historical point of view, and also through those who knew him during his lifetime. Our family hopes that historians and the academe will be able to study the personal papers that he and my mother left, particularly here at Angeles University, at Clark, and with the alma mater, the University of Santo Tomas, and also the books he authored after his term as president. There are also still enough scholars around, including in our province, who were already living during my father's political career, from the time he first ran as congressman, to his senatorial run, to his trying years as vice president, through his trailblazing presidency, to his pivotal role as president of the 1971 Constitutional Convention, to his later years as member of the opposition, to authoritarian rule, and mentor to the next generation of politicians, and to his international involvement in promoting peace and democracy around the world. Manny Angeles is one of these scholars, one who enjoyed a lifetime of friendship with my parents. Thank you, Manny, for your moving tribute to my father and for continuing to keep faith in his legacy. I hope that the Diosdado Macapagal Foundation, which has recently been reconstituted and where Manny is a member, will be able to marshal the proper scholars to document his lasting contributions to the nation. In my father's inaugural speech in 1961, he expressed how he viewed the role of each president. He said, "Nation building is an exacting and endless endeavor. No president can build the whole edifice of a nation. All that he is called upon to do is to add a fine stone to that edifice so that those who shall come after him may add other fine stones that will go for a strong and enduring structure." My father declared that the task of the nation is to fight poverty. He said, "We must be concerned with the plight of the common man as an imperative of justice. We must help bridge the wide gap between the poor man and the man of wealth, not by pulling down the rich to his level, but by raising the poor towards the more abundant life. This philosophy is contained in one of the statements in the photo exhibit, and I thank Angeles University for such a good research. In his twilight years, our father's own assessment of his term's contribution to the edifice of our nation was highlighted to his mind by the abolition of tenancy and the land reform program in the Land Reform Code of 1963. In fact, he said that the signing of the Land Reform Code was the happiest day of his life. My father was born of peasant stock, the only president whose class origins came from the peasantry. And when he became a public servant, he studied Taiwan's successful land reform program, and that became his model as president. Thus, the ultimate purpose of his land reform was to make feasible agro-industrial growth and to make prosperity available for the greatest number. That battle for land reform was an uphill battle. At that time, in the early 60s, the Philippines was controlled by the elite, the political and economic elite, and many of them were hacenderos who contributed heavily to politicians. So therefore, he had great difficulty getting the bill passed in the two houses of Congress. He had to call 8 special sessions until they passed it into law. And that is why August 8, 1963 was the happiest day of his life, the day the Land Reform Code was enacted. Land reform was the flagship of still another trailblazing contribution of our father, the first medium-term Philippine Development Plan to be approved by Congress. He called this medium-term Philippine Development Plan his 5-year socio-economic integrated development program. The economic portion of it was anchored on the philosophy of free enterprise by the private sector. But instead of calling it mere an economic program, his medium-term plan was called socio-economic to emphasize the basic social objective that the prosperity sought must extend to the masses of the people. Thus, he had land reform. He had housing for the poor. He increased the minimum wage law from the first time that it was increased since he, as congressman, authored the minimum wage law. Our father also contributed